We will now go to the last part of this mini conference, and we will go to Edwin Valentine with the announcement of a new book, the first popular science book on the information universe, Powers of Two. And this will be an expedition through the world and skills of information resembling the classic powers of 10. So Edwin, I give the word to you.
There we are. Thank you very much, Carter. Thank you for your great talk. What we call a tough job to follow. I give myself much less time. I will be very short and give a little bit a helicopter view of the book we are issuing in the near future. I think your show is really based on open space. It's building computers. It's using computers and it's using images actually of the two sky, of the two universe. What we do in the computers, I call it the information universe in vitro. Some people call it in silico. And then there's the crossover to the information universe in vivo, the real observe, the real physical information universe. And actually, I've always been thrilled about this crossover. And this is also the subject of this conference. And this is also the subject of the book I'm going to present right now. So I'll give you a little bit of a helicopter view of the book. It is co-authored by a large team of speakers and keynote speakers at the Information Universe Conference. I'm very happy they contributed to it. They really helped to broaden the view. And this is really, you know, a product of this community of the Information Universe. So first of all, I thank all my co-authors for helping and preparing and writing this book. The book is announced by Springer Nature to release in mid-November. The production is a little bit delayed, most likely because of the COVID-19 situation in India. But Springer guarantees me that they give it now high priority and they will have it printed as soon as possible. And as soon as we have it, of course, we will mail it to all the registered guests of the conference. The questions which are addressed in the book are, is there a common denominator that links in vitro to in vivo? Is that information? Is it the building block of everything? Is there a physical difference between in vivo and in vitro? In other words, is our universe one big information processing machine? There are many different approaches to this question, and different speakers have a different view and different approach. But in this book, we follow the powers of two. And it is organized in spreads, two-page spreads, and each of these spreads deals with one of the powers of two. And in this presentation, I highlight a few of them. I will show you a few of them. Clearly, it's not possible to go through all of this, just to give you a little bit helicopter view of what you might expect. It starts a little bit heavy with 2^0, which is quite mysterious, actually. 2^0, as you know, is equal to unity. And in the information universe, we identify that with the space-time form, right? So the universe. The space-time form out of which our universe has been created. During the Big Bang, and in Padmanabhan's speak, during the Big Melt. So, in our book, we call that T instead of space-time form. It's actually also taken over by Padmanabhan to make things a little bit easier to understand, because it's actually a consequence of following the powers of two. If power 2^1 is a bit, can be identified with a bit. A bit has two states. Then we have it from bit, which is the usual statement we make about the information universe, is it from bit. A bit has two states. A bit should also come from something. Bit from T. This is what we present, the way we present it in the book. T being the space-time form. 2^0, one state, the eternal space-time form. And actually, this solves a little bit the riddle of Charlie Lineweaver also addressed in his talk. it's from bit, what is the reverse of it? Where is bit coming from? Well, bit comes from T and space time from. That's the approach. And actually, that is simply, I didn't even plan to say this or to invent this, but it is simple, a consequence if you follow the powers of two. Then if we carry on with power two, there's a spread on the multicellular life and how cells started with exchanging information. And cells started changing information. Really, one can see that there's the moment that real life has started. Then there's the mysterious game of life of John Conway. And I think it's worthwhile to spend some time on that one. The game of life of Conway is well known, it's almost a cult. It only uses a few very simple rules. And by applying these rules in a very simple computer program, which you could already run on the very first MS-DOS computer, you could create creatures and particles and moving things. And here actually we are touching one of the basic properties of the information universe, rules as being a building block of the information universe. Rules you can translate also in relations, and you can translate that also into associations. That's a theme which comes back in the book in many different places. Associations as a building block of the information universe. And that's clearly also the case for the game of life. And also I devote this page to John Conway, who unfortunately passed away recently because of complications of the coronavirus. Then I use this spread of 2^7, which is a spread about ASCII. ASCII is actually a 7-bit string, and it's a table. It's a table of characters or alphabet and the bit string. It links the two. It links the characters and it links the bit string. Actually, it links our computers with our consciousness. We're doing it all the time as we speak, as we type. We're using it all the time without even realizing it anymore. But actually, it is the relation between our consciousness and the computer. Now, what is so strange about it is that this is relation, this is a table, this is an association. And actually, if you think about it, most of our spooky things in our information universe are built out of these, are built on these relations. And this is why the ASCII table is also, I think, a very fundamental thing to understand in information. But actually, I wanted to show you this page to show what we do on typical pages. So we have your 7 bits, and 2^7 bits means 128 states, 128 symbols in the alphabet, and 128 different bit strings. On the lower right, you can find links to other pages. And they are addressed here on this page, and you can find links on other pages. Actually, each spread you can read in a standalone mode. And by following the links, you can make your own storyline through the book. So in the EPUB version, in the electronic version of the book, you can make your own storylines along the power of two. Then just to give you another view of different pages and helicopter view. Here is a page devoted to COVID-19, which enters the storyline at 2^16. And the reason I enter this page is people ask me the question, how can it be that 7.5 kilobytes of information can have such an impact on our society? You know, the RNA virus is only 7.5 kilobytes long. 30 kilobase pairs correspond to 7.5 kilobytes of information. How can it be? I mean, 7.5 kilobytes of information is 1/1000 of a second of this Zoom meeting in terms of information which we transfer to each other. How can it be that such a small thing has such an enormous impact? Well, the big trick is actually that the big trick of nature is that this 7.5 kilobytes is glued together in one big string. There's one big address, one big barcode, if you want. And there are so many mutations of this barcode that you can hear the number 10 to the power 17,000 different mutations of that string. So you can make much more strings than you can even hold in our, contain in our universe. You need many universes to even build all the mutations of this virus. Which means that the virus is completely adapted to us. It's completely adapted to our universe. It's completely adapted to the geometry of our universe. It's adapted to our Earth. It's adapted to our atmosphere. It's adapted to our society and to everything we do in life. And that makes it so clever. Because it's highly, highly, highly selected in an incredible way. And this maybe helps to understand why, by trial and error and selection of nature, nature creates beasts, which are actually a mirror of our own society and our own Earth. All right, well, the same happens actually with DNA, which goes in 2 to the power 30, 32, and Charney Lineweaver did write a spread on this, actually three spreads on this. The DNA string has about 0.5 gigabyte of data, which is enormous. Then there's the take by the life sciences, with a huge biodatabank, and the volumes of these databanks belong to the range of 2 to the power 35. An interesting thing there is that these scientists use these databases to discriminate between the role of nature and the role of environment, the role of nature versus nurture. And actually, this is exactly the same question we have in astronomy. This is why I enjoyed it so much to work together with these people, because on a computer science level, we're doing more or less the same thing they do with this human data and we do with this stuff. Okay, then there is a take by the human brain project. Also there we are dealing with extremely extreme numbers. In the human brain, there are about 10 to the power 15 synapses in a single human brain, which is more than there are stars in the largest galaxy we know of. And actually that brings the human brain in the domain of quantum computing, a single human brain. It also supersedes computer AI by enormous factors. And it also consumes so much less energy. The number is 100,000 billion less energy per synapse if you compare to one transistor in computer chips. Also, this page is devoted to a person, which is called Hans Meiner, who unfortunately diseased shortly after he gave his last talk at the Information University Conference two years ago. Then, of course, there's a take of astronomers who collect big data from the observatories and satellites, such as the Euclid satellite, to map and understand the nature of dark matter and dark energy. And to subsequently ask the question, is it composed of particles and fields or of information? Or is it all information? Such as Erik van Linden had just proposed. And I think this is one of the interesting questions posed in the book. Yeah, I don't think we give all the answers. We give the questions and discuss it together with a number of scientists. And then we observe this stuff. We observe the dark matter. Here's a picture of the KIT dark matter maps displayed on top of the stellar sky in the planetarium. And you see the Big Dipper here in the middle. And on the other side, you see the black hole image, which you all know about. And there's also a page on the black hole, which is written by Heine Falk. Then I go to the next page. Which is about the big data which we are dealing with in astronomy. And astronomy projects really demonstrate the crossover between the big data in our machines and the big data in our universe. And all this transition, this connection, is enabled by spooky links we make. Links is other words for data modeling, metadata, creating links, joins, associations. All different words for the same thing. We make relations and links. The only way we can deal with all the data from the universe is by building that in our computer. And in this context, there are two pages, one on the universe as a spreadsheet and one on downloading the universe. All right. Then here, there's a spread on 4pi. Yeah, it's not a coincidence that 4pi has been mentioned today in several of the talks, because it plays a key role in the information universe. You could say in layman speak, if the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy states that the answer to all the questions is 42, then in the information universe, a lot of the answers to the questions is 4pi. And let me explain that a little bit. Of course, you can find it a bit more details in the book. But 4pi is the amount of information which is transferred from T, or the space-time zone, to the Big Bang, according to Padmanabhan at the Big Mouth. The universe, according to Padmanabhan, the universe started with 4pi of information. But 4pi is also the information content of a sphere, the unit radius, and which is done in the holographic principle. That's a very basic thing. It's a basic thing also for Erik van Linde's theory of dark matter and dark energy. As a matter of fact, it's also the basic thing for the derivation of black body radiation. It's considered as one of the three big inventions in the last century, next to quantum mechanics and general relativity. Also, black body radiation is a 4pi thing. Strange enough, the International Virtual Observatory, which connects over 2,000, perhaps it's already 3,000 different databases all over the world, which everybody can use seamlessly and get information on the sky wherever it is. Actually, the whole virtual observatory is enabled by recognizing 4pi and pixelating the 4pi surface and having all the databases recognizing these pixels on the 4pi surface. So 4pi is actually the geometry of our universe. It's more or less also us. And this is also one of the topics which Robert Dijkgraaf touched in his foreword. This is really the 21st century metaphor. Not necessarily the ultimate theory. We don't have that theory yet, but we all work on it. Okay, well, in these days, you also have to, this internet and fake news, we all know what this is about. We also have to review facts and fakes. And there are some spreads dedicated to this, because it really forces us to review and revisit the system of science and how we determine something to be true or not to be true. What is really the process, how we do that. I close this with the spread of life, but didn't expect that the last page of the book would be about life. I thought it would be up in the big numbers in the universe. But actually, I already revealed that the number of mutations you have in DNA is so incredibly large that you need an unmeasurable amount of universes to get all the different mutations of DNA. Actually, in other words, life is so much more complex than we meet in our astronomical observations. This is remarkable. I find it remarkable. Of course, there will be many people who already knew this. The biologists knew this. Maybe DNA people knew this. But this is rather a remarkable thing. And I find it an interesting conclusion. And it also has some impact on our evaluation of the question, how much life is there in the universe? I personally think if you realize this number, then really doesn't make sense to count the number of planets to evaluate what is the chance to find other intelligent life in the universe. So, yeah, that's one of the main conclusions of the book. And I think I close my presentation here.